Today is really great to have Chase from Decentology.
Yes.
Maybe you start by saying if you make an introduction about Decentology.
Yeah, so we're working on composable smart contracts across a couple different protocols. So we support Ethereum, but we also support Flow, Solana, eventually hopefully Harmony and other like EVM chains. So we're basically making it easy for developers to string together composable contract code that's also pre-audited so that you don't have to worry about the auditing layer of development, which can be a pain.
That's so cool. Maybe you can specifically talk about why Flow would be interesting in such a way of building apps and thinking about composability.
Yeah, so Flow is like one of the first blockchains that we're building it on. They're really well architected from a composability perspective. So they have like a very different architecture from a lot of other chains, and they've thought a lot about composability. And so they were sort of a first step for us. They also are super consumer facing. And one of the things that we believe is, you know, unaudited code on Ethereum is its own challenge. But when you're looking at like mainstream consumers, you really want to make sure that you do have these like auditing layers really, really well done. And so Flow is sort of a perfect first protocol to be thinking about a lot of these things on. And there's just a lot of opportunity there in terms of like the mainstream brands building on something like a Flow, which has been
really cool. It's a really great mission. What is your personal story getting into blockchain?
Yeah, so I was working in marketing doing data analytics and thought it was kind of weird that we were just like using people's data and they weren't getting compensated for it. And so it was just like, this does not make sense. And so I sort of fell down the crypto rabbit hole that way because blockchain was being proposed as this like perfect solution to the data ownership problem. And got more involved, sort of fell in love with crypto, got involved with SHE-256 out of UC Berkeley, and basically got matched with a mentor who ended up becoming my co-founder. So,
so cool.
We started playing around with different projects and seeing how we can make the space more accessible and usable, and ultimately stumbled on this idea that developer tooling is actually like a much broader challenge. And today there's a lot of tooling, I think, that exists in the Ethereum ecosystem, but across other chains, like it's not where it needs to be. And auditing even on Ethereum is sort of questionable. And so we started focusing really heavily on that. And since then have now built out, you know, Decentology, where we're actually transitioning to like a DAO model. So you have developers who can contribute these contracts. You also have auditors who can audit them. They can get paid. So you make both auditing and development instead of like bounty-based linear work. It can become exponential in terms of returns, which we're super excited about.
Yeah, very cool. But you also spend so much time during your college time going around for hackathons. How has experience shaped you?
Yeah, it was really cool. I mean, I think I like to build stuff and like and like ship things and try new things. And so with my co-founder Nick, we went to Shanghai where I saw you.
So much fun.
We went to Seoul. We went to a bunch of different places, basically to like experiment and play around. And that was actually a big part of getting to the point where we realized that like this composable contract aspect is super, super important. And so we had played around with a lot of different things and sort of experimented. And at the time, we were thinking about what, how can we make these things more accessible to mainstream users? But the challenge there was that a lot of this infrastructure for building any sort of application just like did not exist. And so we really started to think about, okay, how can we help with with making a lot of these things faster to build, iterate, test. And so I think that sort of set the scene for a lot of what we're doing now with Decentology.
Yeah, well, you won quite a few hackathons.
And we won a few, which was good.
So it really showed that why composability, but also the security aspect is so critical. But now, I don't know, because of COVID, now that you graduated, you also got really serious about talking about DAO on the podcast. Now it's a really another journey that you're getting into. Maybe you can share about what you've been learning so far?
Yeah, so I think for Decentology, like as we transition to this DAO model, I think it's a, I think it doesn't make sense to build a DAO if you've never participated in one and been part of one. And so a lot of what I started doing was diving much more into the DAO ecosystem and communities because I think it's important, but it's also like I'm super excited about it. And so I'm sort of moving towards more like a community DAO-based role with Decentology and then getting more involved in other DAOs. So I'm involved in Index Co-op, Forefront, I'm helping a little bit with Rabbit Hole and getting their DAO set up and rolling. And so that's been really, really cool to be able to like be immersed in these different ecosystems and really learn what are the best practices, what are the challenges, what does it mean to transition from a product managed by a team to a product managed by a DAO? There are like a lot of challenges that I think you could anticipate and some that you definitely can't anticipate. And so it's been really interesting to dive into all that. And then of course, alongside that, I've done my podcast, which is like a much more human-centric approach to Web3. And we cover DAOs a lot because that's what I'm thinking about all the time.
Yeah, I think all your episodes cover, but also mostly talk with everyone that are doing DAO and building DAO. Now that you are so deep in it, in a year, what do you see that you really wish the DAO has, the whole space would be coming? What kind of impact do you want it to make in a year?
I think two things. The first for me is access. I think the DAOs decentralize access to opportunities to get paid for work that you do. And so I hope that we start thinking about barriers to entry for people. Like, we talk a lot about DAOs are open and there's always access. But the reality is that a lot of off-chain barriers make that not the case, whether it's access to resources or access to, like, hardware or capital or the confidence gap for, like, women, for example. And so I hope in a year we've thought critically about some of those things and actually started to implement processes and programs that help sort of mitigate some of those off-chain barriers. On the flip side of that, I hope that we're able to take a lot of people who traditionally like maybe wouldn't be able to work on things that they love or even find the things that they love and actually start doing them. I think like the transient, maybe not even transient, maybe it's frictionless nature of work within DAOs allows you to explore a lot of things that you actually like instead of being like stuck in a job that you got out of college or the career path that you fell down. And so I hope that those two things end up sort of being at least the path that we're going down for DAOs.
That's really true. What you said about confidence and really having, whether women or underrepresented community, I don't think you lack that. I remember you still being in college and already traveling around, making sure you graduate, but at the same time doing the hackathons and showing up to a basketball game.
And I am not good at basketball.
That's the whole thing about confidence, right? Maybe you can actually say a little bit about it, right? Do whether women or like just college students felt that they are not up there yet to do full time or just like to talk about their ideas in crypto. What is the confidence part that you have seen that all of us need to help them get into the space?
I think what's interesting, one of my favorite people, Jackson Dame, tweeted this a while ago, which was this idea that in crypto, it's harder to have imposter syndrome because there's so much going on all the time. And like the reality is that everything's new. So no one is an expert on anything yet. I think still there's like a lot to learn. And when you come into crypto, the learning curve is, I think, really, really insane. But that being said, I think the willingness to jump into things, be wrong sometimes, but also recognize that like there are no absolute truths in crypto is super important. And everyone's background is really important. I think that's something that's been interesting for me to like navigate, especially as a non-technical co-founder of a developer tooling startup. It's like, where do I provide value?
Right?
And I think once you can lean into your background instead of trying to be technical or trying to think too much about governance if that's not what you care about, or you know, economics or whatever it might be, like lean into the thing that you're good at, and maybe not even good at, but like genuinely interested in. And I think that's where a lot of confidence comes from. Because then your brain's like, oh, I see all these connections and I see some of the stuff that I've done in my past coming up. Because at the end of the day, crypto is about like coordination and humans, even though we're, you know, automating things. It's about humans. So like, humans are humans. There's nothing special about that. And I think understanding that and then applying that is super useful.
Yeah, I love your passion about it. In some ways, it's not just about confidence. You really have the optimism about how this space is driving towards that. Now it's your turn to be the mentor, whether for women or college kids that can get into the space. So my last question would be, how can Harmony be helpful with decentology or the DAO that you also see?
Yeah, I think, I mean, obviously first, like something that we'll do like longer term is implement support for Harmony and other blockchains. I think one of the interesting aspects from a protocol perspective is actually like talking more about auditing and what auditing entails and means. Because it's like
so,
a mess.
So bad.
Especially for protocols that are not Ethereum, where you have like, there are a lot of challenges I think that come with some of this. And what I think we need to have, start having some conversations around is, what does auditing, A, how do we change the incentives for auditing, which we're working on. But B, like, how do we have these conversations around security and auditing in a way that feels accessible to mainstream users as we bring more people in? You don't want to tell people the vulnerabilities of a database that they're using, but you also want to create this almost social layer of don't use an application unless it's audited, particularly if you don't know how to read code.
For sure.
Like if you can't even look at it yourself, you if you're only using a front end to interact with it, you should probably proceed with caution. And so I think from a protocol level, there's a lot of really interesting conversations at the social human level to be had around auditing and what security means.
Totally.
And that's very much aligned with what Decentology is doing.
Yeah, well, congrats on the launch and
thank you.
Yeah, really great having you today, Chase.
Yes, it was so good chatting, catching up.
You.